Greetings, Earthlings. It's been a long time. Apologies for my enforced absence. Things have been very busy and continue to be, unfortunately. So my bench time is very constrained. I do have a couple of projects on the go, but I want to get them finished before I come up with a video for them. So please bear with me. But in the meantime, I thought I'd do a review of something a bit different for this channel. This is an aeroplane. You probably twig that. This is a new release from a little known British company called Airfix, and I don't usually build aircraft and I don't usually review aircraft kits. Basically, the reason that I'm starting to do this now is largely nostalgia. When I were a lad, back in the 14th century, well, back in the 1970s, shall we say, here in the UK, Airfix were the only game in town. So I used to build lots of plastic kits, and probably 90% of them were Airfix. Airfix were easy to get, and they had a big range of, well, it's now obvious to me, really nasty, ropey old crap, but it was all we had, and it was fun. And we used to, you know, my friends used to build these things quite happily, paint them or not, and play with them a bit, and just, it was just fun to build them. And that's kind of where I cut my teeth on building models. And although I kind of shifted over in sort of, probably when I was about sort of 13 or 14, shifted over to mainly doing armour, aircraft kits were my, pretty much the only thing I built when I was little. So what I always wanted to do, because Airfix had a big range of kits, some of them obviously were bigger subjects than others. I always really wanted to do some of their bombers, but I didn't have the money to do it. My family didn't really have the money to just go out and buy kits for me. They didn't really encourage me to spend my money on kits. They kind of thought it would be better to spend it on useful things. But the long and short of it is that I didn't really build any large aircraft, like, ever. So when I was kind of looking around for interesting subjects, because I thought I might like to kind of rekindle this, I was looking at things like the Airfix B-17 and all these other things, and I'd chosen Airfix again for largely for nostalgic reasons. But then Airfix announced they were coming out with this, the B-24H Liberator, which was an interesting subject. So I thought, well, I'll get one of those when they come out. So the Liberator is interesting because it doesn't have quite the glamour. That's not as well known as, say, the B-17 Fly Fortress. But in fact, it was a very widely produced aircraft. They made some, is it more than 18,000 of them or something during the war. And it had a longer range than the B-17. It had a larger payload than the B-17. It was nicknamed the Flying Boxcar because it looks like a box with wings. The wings themselves were a weird design. They were very thin, what they call a Davies wing. And it was a very efficient wing, but unfortunately very prone to damage. So whereas if a B-17 took flak and it damaged the wing, there was a good chance it would just kind of fly home. With the B-24, there was a very strong chance the wing would just fold up against the fuselage and the aircraft and, of course, the crew would be lost. So the crews weren't necessarily wholeheartedly happy with flying these things. But anyway, that's kind of the history. They built gazillions of them, and they were built in all kinds of places. Consolidated kind of had to outwork them to lots of other companies, one of which was Ford. And in fact, this the aircraft depicted here is an H model, which has the I think the Consolidated, is it, style turret on the front, and this is actually a Ford built aircraft, and there are subtle differences between this and aircraft built by other manufacturers, which I'm not going to go into because I don't really know them very well. So I've looked up a bit about this, about these aircraft, and it is interesting. There were zillions of different kind of options and minor changes throughout the run, and yeah, it'd be interesting to see how Airfix has picked these out. So anyway, let's get on with it. This is brand new kit, A09010 is the model number. I'm not going to go into much detail of the box, just to say it has, come on, it has 3 flying hours, so Airfix Club members can add that to their little card with the flying hours on it, and redeem that against another kit once it becomes full. So that's the box with a bit less glare. Lovely, looks like a computer rendering of the subject. Looks very nice indeed. So a quick look in it. Bags of plastic, always good to see. So this has nice sort of dark grey plastic. We'll look at these in more detail out of the bags, but a couple of screws there in a plastic bag. Put that somewhere where I'm not going to step on it or roll a chair over it. Another one seems to have interior parts. Another bag with wings and engines by the looks of it. Set of instructions, always handy, and a large decal sheet with some very large and slightly garish decals. Keep that in to keep it flat. Oh, and there is a separate fold out for the colour guide of two, I think, Liberators. This one is okay. This one appears to be, it's called Corky Burgundy Bombers, and this flew from RAF Old Buckingham in Norfolk. Interesting. And there's another one which is Valiant Lady, which was based in Venosa in Italy, so both from 1944. So interesting. I quite like the Corky one. That looks very interesting. It's got sort of names and stuff all over it. Both of these seem to be standard sort of neutral grey and olive drab. So yeah, looks fairly straightforward, he says, knowing nothing about it. Okay, and the instructions are in the new style Airfix instructions, where whenever a new piece gets added, then it's picked out in red in the subsequent step, which is nice. So you can, you know, easy to orient yourself. There are loads and loads of steps in this. Some of these are some quite small steps, and there's lots of them. How many are there? 130 steps in this. Right, okay, sounds good. Okay, let me get some of the bits out of the bags and we'll have a closer look. Right, let's start with the instructions. I'm not going to go through these in meticulous detail because with 130 steps we'll be here until next Christmas. So I just thought I'd go through and pick out some sort of salient things about this. First of all, I mean, reading this, actually I was wrong. It was an Emerson turret that was added, not a Consolidated. Well, apologies. So yeah, there is a nice little sort of potted history here. It says, it's claimed that Ford could produce Liberators faster than the USAAF could process them into service. So well, that's kind of good. Anyway, First thing I was drawn to was this little note here. It says, due to the size and weight of the rear fuselage and tail surfaces of this model, it requires a large amount of weight to be added to the forward fuselage to enable the model to rest on its nose wheel. That sounds ominous. There are two places where we recommend this is added. So he says blah, blah, blah. And the weight suggested should be regarded as the minimum that needs to be added to avoid a tail sitter. This sounds even more ominous. Alternatively, if the crew entry door under the rear fuselage is fixed in the open position, then the entry ladder can be fixed to support the tail of the model and keep it resting on its nose wheel. So it looks like this will require a lot of weight to stop it being a tail sitter. They are obviously very cagey about this. It sounds like they're not at all. It's not at all a given that this will be done. So it looks like the entry ladder, because the entry to the plane is kind of in the rear of the fuselage, and there's a ladder that hangs down. So I think they've probably come up with two ladders, one that's the correct length, that's kind of hangs down but doesn't touch the floor, provided it's sitting on its wheels. And another one that is just a little bit of a cheat, just slightly long enough that it actually rests on the floor. So you can use that to prop up the plane so it doesn't fall on its backside. So interesting, nice bit of forethought. So anyway, let's carry on. So first of all, start with the interior. Always easier that way, probably, than trying to fit it in afterwards. So we've got some bits, holes to be drilled, nice northern gun sight. So here we have, so we have 25 grams to be added between the instrument panel and the front bulkhead, and another 30 grams to be added underneath. So 55 grams, quite a lot, 55 grams already. Other thing, camouflaged aircraft had their internal skins painted in zinc chromate, but the internal framework was left unpainted aluminium. I've got a feeling that's peculiar to the Ford ones. In the Ford ones, it's slightly weird because the inside of the fuselage here is... it is painted in, it's like a yellowish, greenish yellow zinc chromate primer, but the kind of ribs and spars and things are actually still in just basic aluminium. I think it's because the skin was alclad, as it was called, aluminium cladding, and it was I think it was sprayed in zinc chromate before it was fitted in order to kind of prevent corrosion. And they just didn't bother to do the same thing with the framework. So that's going to be interesting, because it means that while the inside here will be yellow, all of these ribs and spars and things, of which there are lots, will have to be picked out in aluminium. So that'll be a bit of a masking job, maybe a careful dry brushing job. We will find out. So nice, lots of nice internal stuff. So some options here for the rear guns, the waist guns, if you like, because they could be kind of retracted inside the fuselage, and some doors, sort of blanking plates, fitted to keep the draft out. And that's something that Airfix have depicted here. So there's ways to do that. That's good. So we're up to step 50. We're not quite halfway through. That's interesting. As a completely separate, like, cockpit section. Now that hints to me that there will be further versions of this. Probably a BUD, which has like the glass nose, and I think that was the one used by the RAF Coastal Command for sort of anti-submarine and patrol duties. So knowing Airfix, they need no excuse really to make an RAF version. These were very widely used at a very long range, so they were perfect for maritime patrol, and I suspect that there will be in the next couple of years an RAF version with the different nose. Okay, so bombs go in on sort of step 50. Bomb doors can be open or closed. The tail, always seems like separate internal parts for the wing, because they, you'll be able to see the ribbing and what have you through the open wheel wells. Step here that says be careful when assembling parts not to make the wings bow downwards. That'll be interesting to see. Engines, not very nice. There's some nice sort of separate supercharger parts. That looks looks interesting. Okay, so and again, another option, there's optional lowered flaps, so also good. And then the undercarriage, which can be fitted raised or lowered, and then onto things like the turrets. Now this has two different cockpit canopies. I think the differences between these are one of the aircraft depicted, I think Corky, has additional armoured glass fitted. I think it would be on this one. You can just make out there's kind of things here. Probably can't really see that, but yeah, you can see there's panels here. So this, I think, is armoured glass to kind of protect the pilot. And this one doesn't have that, so this will be the kind of as delivered version. I think this one has armoured glass retrofitted. A Corky, I think, did have the armoured glass. It does have a couple of sort of applique armour panels fitted to the side of the fuselage, the side of the cockpit, in fact. So I think that's probably probably going to be the reason for that. So this is one problem, I think, with things like the Liberator, in that there are so many detailed changes of them that if you want to be completely accurate, you may find that very few aircraft were actually delivered with the exact sort of configuration that your kit builds. And it looks like Airfix have kind of fallen foul of this a bit, because of the two aircraft shown here, one of them has the armoured cockpit, one doesn't. So, or at least the armoured cockpit canopy, and the other one doesn't. So it looks like, you know, it could simply be that this was fitted to a few aircraft, but not to others. Yeah, you will need to, I think, check your references very carefully indeed. So, yeah, that's it. So this is, I think, what Airfix were mentioning before. You can fit the boarding ladder here at the rear, and I think this is probably long enough so that it will actually rest on the ground and prop up the rear of the plane. So if you can't manage to get 55 grams, I have to have a look to see how much space there is in there. If you can't get 55 grams of weight in there, then all is not lost. Cool. Anyway, that was a quick gallop through the instructions. Let's have a look at the plastic bits. Okay, so the first sprue out of the box and out of the bag is sprue C. And it's nice to see that Airfix is adopting this style of numbering, as it were, the sprues with a letter that's easy to see. This, I think, this should be required by law on all kits. It makes it much easier than trying to find a little tab and figure out what the letter is on it. So this has fuselage and empennage parts. So the two fuselage halves. These have, you can see here that the fuselage windows would be parallel, but opposite each other in the finished aircraft. That was not always the case. In, I think, later versions, one was shifted forward, one was shifted aft, because there wasn't really room for the two gunners to stand back to back and fire, and they used to sort of walk into each other, which obviously is, well, it's a problem. So that was changed, but for this one, I think that is correct. He says, yeah, I'm pretty sure Airfix would have spotted that. So here's the horizontal stabilizer, the tailplane as we used to call it. Oh, that's interesting. Oh, it is interesting. So these are the tail fins, of which the more astute of you may notice that there are actually four. Yeah, it's definitely four. So again, there's hints at a different version coming along. I couldn't tell you what the differences are off the top of my head, but there probably are. Oh yeah, this one's got a smaller trim tab. If you look here, this has a trim tab that's only that long, whereas this one has a trim tab that's considerably longer. So yeah, that seems to be the main difference. So yeah, kudos to Airfix for spotting that and realizing that at some point they're going to need to make a version with a different size trim tab. Okay, so the other side is even more interesting because it's got some nice sort of interior detail. So sort of nice ribbing inside the bomb bay and inside the rear and forward fuselage. I think from flicking through the instructions, a lot of these ejector pin marks here actually will be covered by other parts. So that it looks very good. Lots of nice apertures here, clean apertures for the scanning windows. There's like the internal framing here. I'm not sure whether you can make this out. It has lots of nice rivet and fastener detail on it. Very nice. Yeah, I've seen crisper, but this does look nice. And on the tailplane here, you can. I'm going to call it a tailplane. You can see here. There's nice, quite restrained rivet detail. The panel detail is recessed, and again, very, very fine recesses. Not too deep. Not too wide. Yeah, looks very nice. Actually, I think it'll take a wash quite nicely. So that's Spruce C. Also in the bag with Spruce C is Spruce A. I'm just looking at this. There's like this has been slightly pushed because there's a let's make out a little bit of a white sort of stress mark there. So I shall need to be careful with that. This sprue has saw some very nice detail. Some more. See, I think this is the is that the bomb bay? I think that's probably the bomb bay roof and the spar. There's some very nice rivet detail there. It's actually quite pronounced. I'm not sure. I suppose it's probably fine, but it wouldn't be flush rivets, isn't it? It's not open to the airflow, so probably doesn't matter. So I'm not sure what all of these parts are. But there's a cockpit floor. That I think is a rear fuselage frame. That's the instrument panel and sort of control binnacle bit. I suppose the throttles would be attached to that. I think this is the rear of the fuselage. I've got a feeling that this leads down into the nose of the plane. Again, here, so this looks. Yeah, I don't know. I'm not going to make it up. I think that's the rear of the rear floor of the fuselage. Some nice detail here of pipes and wires and what have you. That will take a wash very nicely. And what else have we got? These are the details for the inside of the wheel wells. So again, they look very good. These look like ailerons. So posable ailerons, that's nice. These are there's the bomb bays. They're not the bomb bays, those are the flaps. So these are the extended flaps with the mounting points here. These are the retracted flaps. That's interesting. That there, I think, is going to be one of the little sort of box things that Airfix have supplied for the weight for the to stop it being a tail sitter. You're going to have to try and get quite a bit of weight in there. That's going to be a problem, I think. I don't think you're going to fit 25 or 30 grams in there, unless you've got some plutonium squirreled away somewhere. Which, yeah, please don't do that if you've got plutonium squirreled away. Use it for other things. I think this is probably going to need a bit of a scrub. There's a few areas where it's kind of greasy. Looks like mould release type stuff. Yeah, but it looks nice. So this, I think this is the one of the spar. So this is one spar. I think this spar goes along behind it. Yeah, I think that's going to be a very nicely detailed interior. There's lots of nice subtle sort of stuff. I don't know, you can quite make out here. It looks like these areas here are some kind of fabric. You can see there's creases moulded in them, just to give the impression of fabric. That's what it looks like to me at any rate. So yeah, very nice indeed. Very nice indeed. That is Sprue A. Moving on to the next bag, we have Sprue B. This has bomb racks and some bombs and fins for the bombs. Some oxygen bottles of various types. This looks like the boarding ladder. Some seats, detail parts for the interior, aerial parts, and parts for the turrets by the look of it, with very nicely detailed 50 caliber guns. That looks very good. Some aerials. Yeah, these are the kind of doors for the waist gunners. So yeah, some nice detailed parts. Should keep the builder kind of occupied for a while. It looks like this might be a Norden gun sign there. Yeah, very nice. Fairly crisp detail. I mean, it's not excessive kind of detail, but yeah, it's nice. I also wonder how much of this you'll actually see once it's all buttoned up. And things like this radio here, for example, that looks nice. It's kind of, you know, I'm used to coming from larger scales for military kits, where that would be kind of considered a bit a bit crude. But in this scale, it's not too bad, and you probably won't even be able to see it. Anyway, yeah, so Sprue B. In the same bag, Sprue F. This contains, well, I think these are probably the parts that make this the H model, as opposed to anything else. This is the nose of the fuselage with the mount for the Emerson. I had to look it up, and I did. Emerson turret. And this kind of cutout here apparently is characteristic of Ford-produced aircraft. That's very nice. It's fairly, yeah, easy to handle ribbing on the inside. More guns and turret stuff. Yeah, it looks fine. looks fine. Some ammunition feeds. Some of this is a little bit kind of basic and chunky, this detail. But there's nice, again, there's nice fastener detail here. You can probably make out the rivets and things. So not at all bad. A couple of mounts here for turrets and things. Yep, that I think will be one of the sprues that is swapped out for subsequent versions. But this one is for the H, and that is Sprue F. Also in that bag, another bag, and this one contains two clear sprues. I was going to say they were neatly packed in the bag, but this one actually, the bag actually is split open. So we can take a look here. This is Sprue X, and it has lots of transparent bits for things like the scanning windows. One of the turrets here, I think this is the, I imagine the nose turret. And this is the fuselage, the cockpit canopy. And you can just make out it's got a slightly boxier sort of front window here, and these side windows here have got kind of boxy surrounds. Those denote the armoured glass. So that's very much for this model of Liberator. But I'm going to take this one out because I'll probably lose bits. You can just make out in here that this is the other sort of non-armoured canopy. And then we have other sort of transparent parts that are common to most kind of models rather of this aircraft. It's interesting, this is obviously parts of a turret here. The guns are actually moulded in the clear section, so that'll be a laugh. Okay, and the nose glazing for the bombardier station there with its optically flat surface. Yep, looks very nice, commendably clear. Probably do with a dip in Johnson's clear before use. But yeah, nothing, no obvious kind of difficulties with that. So that's sprue X and Z already. X and Z, we're at the end of the alphabet, what's going on? And the final bag contains two sprues. This is the first one, this is sprue D. And it contains, well, no prizes for guessing, it contains parts for the wings and the engines. So the wings again have nice sort of panel detail and fastener detail. That's very nice. Well, it's determined not to focus on it. There he goes, some nice detail there for the access panels for the engine cells. That looks good. That's the underside of the wing also has some very nice sort of panel detail. We have the wings, the cells. These are obviously upper and lower halves of the cells that sort of clamp over the wings when they're assembled. Four propellers, which these are only. I had a feeling that these were kind of two identical sprues. Actually, would have been very bad if they were, because the wings would have to have gone upside down. But the propellers are here with the little spinny axle things. The engines are okay. I mean, I'm not a big expert on aero engines. These look, they have probably enough detail that a nice oily wash will be able to bring that out. And a bit of detail painting. The gearboxes are separate. They'll be a different colour to the engines anyway, so you might be able to paint them separately and add them later. The gearboxes, I assume, will be the bits that the spinners, the sort of axles fit into. So my guess would be that you could build all the engines up and fit them, paint them and fit them, and then in the last, for your last step, get the pre-painted gearboxes and pre-painted propellers, and then fit them to the gearboxes, then just fit the gearboxes in like a final step, just to make it a bit easier so you don't accidentally wipe the propeller blades off as you're working on the model. So that's an interesting thing. So you'll notice here, I have a short shot part, this piece of the cowling here. That should look like that, but it doesn't. It has, it's just kind of missing some plastic. So that's what we call a short shot, where there's not enough plastic has been pushed in to quite fill the mould. That is annoying, probably not disastrous, because I can probably just put a piece of plastic card in there and file it. Other things we've got, these look like bits for the superchargers. Hmm. Yep, that is sprue D. And the final sprue foil consideration is sprue E, which basically continues the wings and associated gubbins theme with the starboard wing, which is very much, as you might expect, a mirror image of the previous one. Well, this sprue is different. This has the superchargers in it, has the bombay doors with loads of rivets on them. Those will probably look really nice under a wash. That'll probably bring those out nicely. I think those are the closed nose wheel doors. The undercarriage struts are here. These, I think, are the retracted undercarriage. And then there's other sort of undercarriage bits, nose wheel bits. And interesting, you can make that out. There's two thicknesses, it doesn't really show very well. Two thicknesses of wheels here. I think that some of these wheels, these outer wheels here, these are in two parts. And I think they sandwich, I think, these parts in between them to give you the extended wheels, the wheels on the ground. They've got nice flat spots molded in them. So when your aircraft is depicted standing on the ground, you use these ones. But these two in the middle are just it's kind of molded for one side only, and they are a bit thinner. And they will be the ones for the retracted wheels, because the wheels will show. But you don't want them to be the full depth, because they probably won't fit. So it's looking very nice. And there's the nose wheel. It's looking very good. It's just kind of what you'd expect, I suppose. I'm just looking at some of the detail. I think from my day back when I built these things myself, we didn't have any nice detail like this. Detail is generally raised, rivets were like pimples all over it. So it is nice to see this kind of level and a bit of finesse here. Very nice. And I do get the impression, again, I haven't checked it against plans or whatever, but I do get the impression that Airfix have done their homework. This is also a very pleasing detail on these wings. Very good. That, sprue. So the final thing to show you is this. This is the decal sheet, or decal sheet if you're so inclined, protected with a nice piece of greaseproof paper. So there are three sections to this. A section for, we'll call it Corky, a section for Valiant Lady, and the section that's common to both aircraft. What I will say is that there don't seem to be all that many. I'd expect there to be a lot more sort of stencils and things in the common section. There are quite a few. I think a lot of these, this is bomb, so these are obviously markings for the bombs. And there's common ones, that's the instrument panel. That looks, these look like other kind of instrument panels. Some warning placards. I think it says fire extinguisher. So nice. I mean, these are made by Cartograph, I think. They are, certainly there's a Cartograph logo on the box. Cartograph are very well renowned for the quality of their decals, so I don't think these will cause too many problems when you come to use them. A couple of things I'm not too keen on. One is that the things like this, these are for the white stripes on the outside of the tail fins. And the white stripes with a black N in them. I would be far happier. actually just masking and painting the white stripe than trying to use these decals. Yes, it would be nice to have a separate black end just to put on the painted stripe. As it is, I'll probably just have to chop those out close to the letter, and yeah, try and get them on. Hope that the additional bit of white around here doesn't show. But other than that, it's not a big deal. These have bits chopped out of them because I think they go over the windows, or the windows, or the waist gunner's position. So these sections here, I think, actually are painted over the the doorways that actually fold inwards on the aircraft when it's in flight. So they've been rendered separately, which is very nice. Notice that these are kind of a not blue and white, but blue and grey. They have kind of a low vis marking there. So nice low vis markings with big white stripes and corky and orange. So yeah, a bit of a mixed message there. Bomb cocktails, it says. They've missed this K out of cocktails. Well, whatever. Pete the Treat, Bill's Bar. Yes, it had stuff all over it. Don's Yo-Yo Department, Dottie Evelyn, Miss Elaine. Oh yes, I suppose every crew member had a say in what went on. And the 485th Bomb Group one, the one based in Italy. Kind of, again, I would have been more inclined to paint this yellow rather than try and use a decal. But these probably okay. But yes, I would have preferred to have basically had a separate set of numbers here and paint the rest. I'm sure I could chop these out here and fit them on. I mean, that's just a bit nitpicky, but that would be my preference. And yeah, that's basically it. There's some bomb run decals there. How many is that? 39 bombing missions. And a valiant lady with a picture of Lady Liberty there. Isn't that nice? And a Liberator with a picture of Lady Liberty. Anyway, them's the decals. And that's basically everything that's in the box. So, yeah. Let me just pack everything neatly away before I lose it, like I will inevitably do. And then we all sum it up. So there we have it. This is Airfix's new, brand new, in fact the parts are still warm out in the moulds, 1/72 scale consolidated B-24H Liberator. So a brand new moulding, and there was one of these in Airfix's range many years ago. This has nothing in common with that. And it does look like a nice kit. I'm very impressed with the sort of surface detail. There's nice interior detail. Yeah, I mean, if you really want to, you could go to town with that and add cabling and bits and pieces. I'm not sure how much of it will even be seen through the sort of various apertures. Hopefully I'll be able to fit enough weight in the nose section that it will actually not fall on its backside. Yeah, it does look like a nice kit. A little bit disappointed at sort of some quality control. The short shot part was a bit of a surprise and not a welcome one. Yeah, it looks good. I mean, I'm looking forward to building this, like I said, mainly for nostalgia value, even though it's a brand new kit. Yeah, building Airfix stuff was something I used to do as a kid, and I thought it'd be nice to give another go now I'm grown up. And now Airfix kits are much more sort of detailed and sophisticated as well. So, and also this is the first kind of heavy bomber that I will have built, because I just never got the opportunity as a kid. So yeah, looking forward to it. I will probably start building it in the next few weeks. I do have other things on the go at the moment, and I want to get out of the way. It's kind of proving slow going, But I do want to get to this. Yeah, it looks like a nice build. Interesting subject. And I think Airfix have done a good job with it. They seem to have paid attention to details, and they seem to have done their homework, and not just made some kind of just completely generic aircraft and slapped some decals on it and said that will do. They've kind of said, well, yeah, this one, for example, had the armoured glass and the other one didn't, and we will accommodate that. So, yeah, well done Airfix for that. It's fine. If you wonder why I'm not gushing about it, I like I said the externally I think it's really nice. Internally it doesn't matter so much. But that was kind of okay. But I'm not quite sure what I expected. Having said that, really, what would you do? It looks like it should be a fun build, and I'm sure once it's built up and in the display case, it'll look very good indeed. Do I recommend it? Oh yeah, I think I do, actually. It's a new tooling. The part breakdown looks very sensible. Airfix have actually bothered to think about how a modeler will be building it. They've annotated the instructions accordingly. That's good. I like that. I think it'll be quite a sort of a satisfying build. So that's it for now. That's my first aircraft kit review. I hope that you enjoyed it. I hope it was useful. Please click the like button. That really does help. Having the likes really does actually wake up YouTube's algorithm to the fact that this channel exists. Subscribe if you like to, that would be most excellent. To my existing subscribers, thank you for your patience. It's been a long time since I've actually done anything else, and thanks for sticking around. There will be more to come. I can't promise that I'll suddenly have a massive output, but I'm starting to kind of crank up and do a bit more stuff now on the camera. So anyway, enough yaffle. Thank you for watching, and until next time, which hopefully will not be too long away, happy modelling and goodbye.